I believe in the year 2017, we're living in the last of the last days. And I'm sure we all believe that Christ is even now at the doors, I would say, that he's his second coming. The things that are happening in the world are so heated up at the minute that there's so many things going on that Christ will return soon. I believe that with all my heart. I believe that whenever we look at world events, now we're not here to look at world events this morning, but when we look at world events, I believe everything is pointing to the imminent return of the great God, even our Saviour, Jesus Christ. And this morning I want to speak to the church mainly, and I want to speak on God is raising Elijahs in these last days. I believe there's a start of this happening. God is raising Elijahs in these last days. I believe there's a revival to come yet to the British Isles and to the United States before the coming of the Lord. Everywhere else seems to be having it, but I think that there's going to be another one. And I'll tell you why if you turn to Malachi, please, chapter 4. The lighting isn't fantastic here, so I just might move this forward. Malachi chapter 4. There's only six verses in the book of Malachi, and so we'll read the full six verses and then we'll refer to it. Malachi chapter 4. Last book, last chapter of your Old Testament, if that helps you. There's plenty of room in this lectern here, this pulpit, to be able to put a watch and everything on it. It's great. Some of them you can't even get your Bible on. It's fantastic. Verse 1 says, "For behold, the day cometh that shall burn as an oven, and all the proud, yea, and all that do wickedly shall be stubble. And the day that cometh shall burn them up, saith the Lord of hosts, that it shall leave them neither root nor branch. But unto you that fear my name shall the Son of Righteousness arise with healing in his wings. And ye shall go forth and grow up as calves of the stall. And ye shall tread down the wicked, for they shall be ashes under the soles of your feet in the day that I shall do this, saith the Lord of hosts. Remember ye the law of Moses, my servant, which I commanded unto him in Horeb, for all Israel with the statutes and judgments. Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. And he shall turn the heart of the fathers to the children, and the heart of the children to their fathers, lest I come and smite the earth with a curse." Let's just pray again. Father, we thank you that your Spirit is here. And we thank you, Lord, that you'll speak to hearts this morning. We ask you, Father, that you would deal with your church. And, oh God, that you would deal with our nation. And we pray this morning, Father, also if there's one here or more here that do not know your Son as their own Lord and Savior, then this morning, Father, would you save them? For we believe, Lord, that that day is imminent when your Son will return. So, Father, help me to rightly divide the word of truth, to break this bread of life, and may we feast on it and live well to the glory and to the honor of the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We ask it for his glory. Amen. You know, the Old Testament here, the last chapter, the last book, so the last words of the last chapter of the last book tells us of impending judgment and doom. It's not a very good way to leave someone, is it? But this is the last time, really, that the Lord had spoken in such a measure for 400 years until the coming of John the Baptist and what we have in our New Testament. When John the Baptist comes, and he comes with a message saying, repent. And that was the message to Judah at that time. Israel are gone at this time. But he's saying, repent, and that's the message still today. That salvation can only be found at repentance. Repentance from our sin. And notice what the prophet says here in verse 1. For behold, the day cometh that shall burn as an oven. And all the proud, yea, and all that do wickedly shall be stubble. And the day that cometh shall burn them up, saith the Lord of hosts. So here's a terrible day coming for those who don't know Christ. Here's a day coming upon the earth that are not Christ's own. We have to look at something else here. The Lord then gives us a glimmer of hope. A light shines through in verse 2. And he says, "But unto you that fear my name shall the Son of Righteousness arise with healing in his wings." The second coming of Christ, he is the Son of Righteousness. For there's none righteous, no, not one. Not one of us are righteous in our own selves. We're not righteous because of who we are. We're not righteous by what we can do. We cannot be righteous by what we can give. But we can only be righteous because we are in Christ. And it's the righteousness of Christ upon a man and a woman that causes a man and woman to be righteous enough, if I can put it in that term, to enter into heaven or the kingdom of God when he comes. Notice this. He says, "The Son of Righteousness shall arise with healing in his wings." The day when Christ returns, the sky shall roll back like a scroll. Now listen, brethren and sisters, there's no such thing as a secret rapture. There's no such thing as the church being caught away and then 144,000 Jewish Billy Grahams converting the world without the blood of the Lamb, without the Holy Ghost. We can only be saved through the regeneration of the Holy Spirit. We can only be saved through the washing of the blood of the Lamb. We can only be saved by putting our full trust in Christ and in Christ alone and receiving his righteousness upon our own lives and over our own souls. So when the Lord comes, we're going to see myriads and myriads of heavenly beings coming in the skies. The sky shall roll back like a scroll, and every eye shall see him. Every eye will see Christ when he returns. Now, whenever we look at the Son of Righteousness rising with healing in his wings, we may look at it a little more in a moment if we have time. But what we also have to remember here, Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 about the resurrection of the dead when Christ returns, and then the changing of the body of the redeemed saints of God. And at that time, we will be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. So let's look then at 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, Mark Malachi chapter 4, please, too. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. You're going to be also doing a bit of Bible reading today so you can read it and get it into your spirit. Chapter 4, verse 13, Paul says, "But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep," or those who have died already, the Christians who had died, "that ye sorrow not even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them which also sleep or died in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first." Now, there's nothing secret about that. Let's read verse 16 again. "The Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout." Not secret, with a shout. "With the voice of the archangel," it's not a secret, there's a loud voice, it's a war cry, "and with the trump of God filling the skies." And so we see the dead in Christ shall rise first. Listen, my loved ones that I laid to rest in the grave who are in Christ, they're going to rise out of their grave. And your loved ones who have died in Christ, the graves will open and they will rise out of their grave. It's not a wonderful thing to behold. We're going to be there, whether we die, then we will be resurrected too. So the Son of Righteousness rising with healing in his wings is this, that when Christ returns, those who know the Son of God, those who have trusted in the blood of the Lamb, those who have the righteousness that he gives and have been to Calvary and are washed by faith in his precious blood, we will rise again from the very grave should we go there. I think it's marvelous, isn't it? Would you say amen, brothers and sisters? God is a wonderful God. Christ is a wonderful Christ. He is a wonderful Savior. Notice this, there's nothing secret about it. The dead will rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Now listen, we're not floating off to heaven either. We're returning to planet Earth. Where is Jesus coming to when he returns? He's coming to set up his kingdom on the earth. So if we're going to forever be with the Lord, where are we going to be? We're going to be with Christ. When he returns, we shall come with him, and we shall rule and reign with him for 1,000 years as he sets up his millennial kingdom. Notice what it says, so shall we ever be with the Lord, wherefore comfort one another with these words. Are you comforted by that? You see, I'm comforted by it to know, one, that Christ is returning. I'm comforted to know that when I see this world and all the calamity that's in it, when I see this world and I hear of all the violence and I see all the things that are happening and I see the sin and I see our nation and the depravity it's fell into, and whenever we think sometimes, you know, we're beat, we're devastated, we're down, the church must be near finished by now. Listen, Christ says, I will build my church and the gates of hell or death shall not prevail against it. So Christ is going to do another work, I believe, before this great and dreadful day. But you said that you're encouraged. You said you're encouraged. Has it a great and dreadful day? If you're not Christ, it's a great and dreadful day. If you're not saved, it's a great and dreadful day. But unto us who are saved, it is the call, the blessed hope of the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, or the great God who is even our Savior, Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is the great God. And he's coming again in clouds of glory. Turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, please. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. This is what Paul says whenever Christ returns. And if you link this in, when the dead in Christ rise first, then we which are alive and remain will be caught up with them. Notice this. Verse 51, 1 Corinthians 15, 51. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. Now, note that. Paul says we shall not all sleep. We'll not all die. Now, if Christ tarries, we're all going to die. It's as simple as that. If Christ tarries, we will all die. But if Christ comes before we die, then we'll not all die, or be some alive and remain. There'll be some who have died. If you're in Christ, you'll have died in Christ. And Paul says, we shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. Notice that. So whether we die in Christ or we are alive in Christ at his second coming, whatever one it is, we'll all be changed. What will we be changed like? He says we'll be changed, first of all, in a moment. Will you say in a moment? We will be changed in a moment. Will you say that? We will be changed in a moment. It doesn't say we'll be caught up in a moment. That's what we're taught. Let's see what the Bible says. It says we shall be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. The change comes as quick as that. The change comes in an atom of time. And we will have a body without pain. We will have a body without tiredness and weakness and weariness. And there'll be no more cancer, and there'll be no more tumors. There'll be no more kidney disease. There'll be no more diabetes. There'll be no more suffering, no more sorrow, no more death. For death will be swallowed up of life. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall we also appear with him in glory. Isn't that a wonderful thing? That we are Christ, and when he comes, you and I will be like him. We will be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. What's the last trump? Well, Paul told us again in 1 Thessalonians 4, when he returns. The dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Brothers and sisters, do we understand when we read this that whenever we are laboring for Christ, that when you're laboring in his harvest field, because I'm bringing you somewhere with this, God is raising Elijahs in these last days. We are living, our nation, your neighborhood where you are is God's harvest field. Where you are, God is raising men and women up, and he's filling them with the Spirit, and he's given them the truth of his word in opposition to all that's happening in our land. And there may be few, there may be far between, who are willing to stand up and stand out and speak up and speak out for Christ. But I'll tell you something, those whom God sends forth, he will equip to do. He'll equip you to do it. Now notice this. When we look at our reading in Malachi chapter 4, and verse 1 says, "For behold, the day cometh that shall burn as an oven, and all the proud, yea, all that do wickedly, shall be stubble. The day that cometh shall burn them up, saith the Lord of hosts." Notice what verse 5 says. It talks about the coming of the great and dreadful day. Three things to notice. First of all, in verse 1 we have, "The day cometh." You can underline it. "The day cometh." Then, again in verse 1, "The day that cometh." Notice, "The day cometh." "The day that cometh." You see, the Holy Spirit, through the prophet, is telling us, "The day's coming. The day's coming. The day's coming." Now listen, if you're not saved, let me tell you something. We're always thinking that we stand at someone else's graveside. But what if it was yours? We're always thinking it's someone else that gets the bad news. But what if it came to your door, your family, your home? Are you ready? Are you saved? The day is coming when Christ will return. And we don't know the day, we do not know the hour, but the day is coming. Notice what it says. "The day cometh, then it says, "The day that cometh," in verse 1 again, and in verse 5 emphasizes. Now this is at the very end of your Bible. There's only one little verse, and there is no verses in the original, we know that. But this is right at the end of your Old Testament Bible. Notice what it says. It says, "Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord." Now, if we look through our New Testament, can we say the great and dreadful day of the Lord? I know there are those who believe that AD 70 and the idea that all scriptures fulfilled in AD 70 and we don't need to worry about all those things now. And listen, is that the great and dreadful day of the Lord for you and I? Is that the great and dreadful day of the Lord for this latter-day people living in the last days? I don't think so at all. It was only in Jerusalem. It was only a little spot. Whenever we think this is a worldwide cataclysmic event at the coming of Christ. Now notice this. The day cometh, the day that cometh, the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. You see here the word here, the great. It's a word gadol in the Hebrew language, and it means great in any sense and great in every way. There's a day coming that's great in any sense you can imagine it. And there's a day coming that's great in every way that you can imagine it. Let me give you an example. Psalm 95 and verse 3. It says, "The Lord is a great God, and a great King above all gods." So notice here the psalmist is saying, the Lord or Yahweh is a great God, and he's a great King above all gods. Now the gods is a small g because there only is one God. And so we notice here that Yahweh is great in every way and in any sense. Everything and anything that you and I come up against, he can take care of. He is in control of. He is still on the throne over
He is the King of Kings and he is the Lord of Lords. You see, when Christ returns, he's the great King. He's the King above kings and he's the Lord above all other lords. He's great in every sense and he's great in every way. It's unimaginable that which Christ is when he returns. And it's unimaginable what he is as God even at this present moment. He's a great King and he's a great God. There's nothing impossible with him. Listen, his love is great. And brothers and sisters, if we hadn't the love of God in our life, I think it was our brother Raymond said, prayed, a love of God is greater far. Could we think the ocean fill and were the skies of parchment made, were every stalk on earth a quill, and were every man a scribe by trade to write the love of God above, should drain the ocean dry, nor could the scroll contain the whole, though stretched from sky to sky. The love of God is great in every sense and in every way. And when God sets his love on his people from before the foundation of the world, he doesn't lift his love back off them again. God doesn't love you 1 minute and then unlove you the next. And God doesn't love you less today than he did yesterday, or more today than he did yesterday because you've came out today. He loves you with an everlasting love. And that love has never, ever changed. Notice this. He's great in every sense, in every way. His mercy is great. His grace is great. His compassions are great. Every sense and in every way. Christian, don't fall by the wayside. Don't turn back and take your hand from off the plow and keep plowing on. Because I'll tell you why. Because God is greater. God is greater than what your mind thinks. God is greater than what your heart feels. God is greater than the tiredness of your body. God is greater than the hurts of your life. God is greater, and God is raising up men and women this time, and he wants you at this moment. Today, let it be a threshold day that you'll stand up and stand out for the Lord Jesus Christ and for his kingdom. Notice this here. The day of the Lord is great, and it's a dreadful day. Now, what a way to finish the scriptures of the Old Testament. I know the Apocrypha is in the middle. I don't class them as inspired. They're good for historical purposes. But nevertheless, they had the Maccabees in 1st and 2nd, Esdras and so on, and there's different books in there. But for our canonized version and to stop the scriptures here, God says, I'm coming. There's going to be a great and a dreadful day. He says, and my son, he will return again. Do you know God's away ahead of you? We think sometimes the cross is an afterthought. There is no plan B, by the way. There's no sacrifice in a temple in Jerusalem plan B either. There's no plan B of works and religions. There's no plan B of anything else but the blood of Christ. There's no plan B but the work of the cross. There's no plan B but when Jesus cried, it is finished. He paid it in full. Never be repeated again. There is no plan B. There's no plan B in who you are and what you can be and what you can do and what you become. There's no plan B in the many times you come to a Christ Encounters meeting. There's no plan B you go to another church somewhere. There's no denominational plan B. It's the cross and that's it. The cross plus nothing. The blood of Christ and nothing else. He is more than sufficient for all of our sin. He is more than sufficient to meet all of our needs. That's why he's called the great I am. I am that I am. He's present tense. Everything that we are and everything that we need. Everything that we need to have. Notice this. He says here that the day is great and it's at the very last of your Old Testament. 400 years. 400 years until John the Baptist comes preaching in the wilderness. Repent ye, for the kingdom of God is at hand. Now, notice this. Let your eye run down to verse 6. And he shall turn the heart of the fathers to the children, and the heart of the children to their fathers, lest I come and smite the earth with a curse. Now, the idea of this is, in John the Baptist's day, they'll look back to the God that brought them out of Egypt. The God of Abraham, and the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. They'll look back to the God of the prophets. They'll look back to the God of their fathers who wrought great miracles. They'll look back to the God who split the Red Sea coming out of Egypt. They'll look back to the God who fed them manna in the wilderness. And they'll look back, it says, and they'll look back to what their fathers did, not to live there, but to realize that God today is the same God then, he is the same today, and he always will be. And he's saying this ministry will turn men and women back to the one true living God. This ministry will turn men and women to serve the one true living God, to believe the one true living God, who've done wonders past finding out, great miracles, signs, and wonders done in the nation of Israel. And he's saying, when this ministry comes, they will turn back again. You know what's happening in many churches? They're throwing out the Old Testament. We're New Testament Christians. Now listen, we're Old Testament Christians. It's a Old Testament. We have 66 books. We're under the New Covenant. We're washed in the blood. But Christ is from Genesis chapter 1 right to the end of the book of Revelation. He is from start to finish. He is the Alpha and the Omega. He's the beginning and the ending. He's the first and the last, and he's everything in between. And we see him through every scripture. And to cast out the Old Testament means you're casting out all those books of his glory in the nation. Notice this, of Israel. Notice this. Will you let your eye roll? Tell you what, let's turn to Luke chapter 21. Luke chapter 21. Is everybody all right still? Yes? Okay. I'm sure most of you know me anyway, but I get a bit excited at times. Luke chapter 21. Luke 21. Let your eye run down just to verse 25. The Lord Jesus is speaking. He says, there shall be signs in the sun and in the moon and in the stars. Notice, and upon the earth, distress of nations with perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring, men's hearts filling them for fear and for looking after those things which are coming on the earth, for the powers of heaven shall be shaken. And then shall they see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. And when these things begin to come to pass, then look up and lift up your heads, for your redemption draweth nigh. What's happening here? The Son of Righteousness is arising with healing in his wings. The Son of Righteousness is bringing our whole redemption, the change of the body. The Son of Righteousness, Christ himself, is returning. Notice what it says here in verse 25. There shall be signs in the sun, in the moon, in the stars, and upon the earth, distress of nations with perplexity. The word perplexity is the word aporia, and it means in a state of quandary, no way out. Can I ask you, brothers and sisters, is our world that we live in today, is our planet, are the nations of this world in a state like that now? They are, aren't they? There's no way out. They're in a state of quandary. They're stuck fast. They've went into a cul-de-sac and they can't get themselves out. Listen, the Antichrist beast system of Europe is falling. Praise God. And it's going to come down. It's going to crash down. It's falling. Babylon the Great is falling. It's falling. And all the Antichrist system religion of the world, it will fall too. It's trying to raise its head. And it's trying to gather in all people to ecumenize together. This is why we need Elijah's raised up in our nation. Rome is bringing everybody in together. They're calling all the nations and all the peoples with all the religions. And now they're even saying whether you're living and practicing a homosexual lifestyle or if you believe in the virgin birth, well, it doesn't really matter. It doesn't matter now, according to one of the latest memes from the Pope, he's saying that men and women can get into heaven without personally knowing Christ, without coming to personal salvation in Christ. And many Protestant denominations are following suit. How many churches do you go to and you won't hear the gospel of saving grace? How many churches will tell you that Christ is coming and you must be ready, you must be born again, you must be saved? How many churches are forcefully, as it were, in the sense that they are forthrightly preaching the gospel of saving grace? I know there are churches that do it, but how many are not? How many are telling people, well, you're a good this, that, or the other. You know, you're a good man, you're a good woman. You don't really need to be saved. Oh, that fellow up there in the chimney corner in Christ's Encounters, he just gets carried away with himself. Jesus says to a man who came to see him by night, Nicodemus, he says, except a man be born of water or from above, you must be God's birth in you. You cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. You must be born again, he says. Now, notice this. We're in a state of perplexity. We're in a quandary. There's no way out. Things that are coming on the earth, men's hearts are filling them for fear. And Luke 21 and 27 says, then shall they see. It doesn't say, then shall I sneak. I'll sneak in and nobody will see me and everybody will vanish. That's fairy tales. Then shall they see. He says, they'll see me. The only get-out clause from Malachi 4 and 5 is, behold, I send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. That's the only get-out clause mankind has. That's the only get-out clause you and I have. When the Son of Righteousness comes with healing in his wings, is being ready for that coming. So what do I mean about sending you Elijah the prophet? Okay, I want to look at a few scriptures here and ask you to bear with me, and we'll flick through them and read them. I want you to read it yourself so as you can get it into your own spirit and into your own heart. First of all, when we read this, he says, behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day. In Matthew chapter 11, if you want to turn with me. Matthew chapter 11, please. And we'll just lift a couple of verses out. Let's read from verse, I'll tell you what, let's read from verse 11. We'll lift a few verses out. Jesus says, verily I say among you, unto you, among them that are born of women, there hath not risen a greater than John the Baptist. Notwithstanding, he that is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. He that is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. That's another study for another time. But you have the indwelling spirit. Well, look at that. This is where Christ is alluding to here. For from the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffereth violence, and the violent take it by force. For all the prophets and the law prophesied until John. That's up to Malachi, okay? They prophesied 400 years, and then we have John the Baptist coming, preaching, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. For all the prophets and the law prophesied until John, and if ye will receive it. Imagine Jesus saying that. You'd think if Jesus was here and talking to us in person, he would say, if you'll receive it. He wouldn't have to say that. He means in the spirit. Notice this. And if you will receive it, this is Elias or Elijah, which was for to come. He that hath ears to hear, let him hear. Now, Jesus says, John the Baptist is Elijah. Stay with me. Don't let me lose you. Turn with me to John's Gospel, please. Turn with me to John's Gospel, chapter 1. John's Gospel, chapter 1. Verse 19. And this is the record of John when the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, who art thou? So now these priests and Levites are asking John the Baptist who he is. Who art thou? And he confessed and denied not, but confessed, I am not the Christ. And they asked him, "What then? Art thou Elias? Are you Elijah?" And he saith, "I am not." "Art thou that prophet?" And he answered, "No." And they said unto him, "Who art thou, that we may give an answer to them that sent us? What sayest thou of thyself?" He said, "I am the voice of one crying in the wilderness, make straight the way of the Lord, as said by the prophet Isaiah," or Isaiah. So they come and they ask him, "Are you Elijah that Malachi prophesied of? Are you the Elijah to come?" He says, "No, I'm not." They said, "Are you that prophet?" And he says, "No, I'm not." He says, "Who are you?" "Well, I'm the one Isaiah prophesied of. I'm not Elijah, though." Now, Jesus said he was, and John said he wasn't. We have a problem here. Jesus said, "This is Elijah that was to come." John says, "I am not." Jesus, God in flesh. Jesus, the man who has the Spirit without measure. And now John is the man filled with the Holy Spirit, even from his mother's womb. Who's right? And who's wrong? Well, both of them are right, none of them are wrong. Both of them are right, and none of them are wrong. Turn with me to Luke's Gospel, chapter 1, please. Jesus had said, "He who has ears to hear, let him hear." Friend, he who has ears to hear this morning, let them hear. Notice this. Luke chapter 1. Let your eye run down. Zacharias, John the Baptist's father, before he's born, is in the temple. And of course, he's visited by the angel. And this is what he says about John the Baptist. Let your eye run down, please. To verse 13. "But the angel said unto him, Fear not, Zacharias, for thy prayer is heard, and thy wife Elizabeth shall bear thee a son, and thou shalt call his name John. And thou shalt have joy and gladness, and many shall rejoice at his birth, for he shall be great in the sight of the Lord, and shall drink neither wine nor strong drink, and he shall be filled with the Holy Ghost, even from his mother's womb. And many of the children of Israel shall he turn to the Lord their God, and he shall go before him in the spirit," notice, "in the spirit and power of Elias," or Elijah. "John the Baptist shall go before them in the spirit and the power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord." Notice, Jesus says this is Elias. If you can hear it, he says, if you can receive it. John says, "I am not him." Jesus says, "He is him. He is Elijah. If you can receive it, he that has ears to hear, let him hear." Then John says, "I am not him." But the angel says, John the Baptist will fulfill the role in the spirit and the power of Elijah. It's the Elijah ministry in John the Baptist, the forerunner, the one crying in the wilderness from Isaiah's prophecy. So they were both right. And that's why Jesus was saying, if you can receive it, understand there's a bigger picture behind everything you see. Jesus is saying, look, it's the Spirit. I know people saying, now this brought into, we're going to look at it, that before the great and dreadful day of the Lord, the Lord's going to raise up Elijah literally. I don't believe that at all. I don't believe that. I believe the resurrection is going to come when Christ comes, and that's it. But notice this. Here we have the spirit and power of Elijah in John the Baptist. So is everyone with me on this? I need you to catch this before we go any further. So what happens in the last day when Elijah is raised up? Well, it's simple. Whenever we turn, we'll not do it for time's sake. When we do it, turn to Acts chapter 2. There were 120 in the upper room. And they were all, for fear of the Jews, hiding there. And they were seeking the face of God, and they were fretting and wondering what to do next, having their prayer meeting. And suddenly, there came a sound as of a mighty rushing wind from heaven, and cloven tongues like as of fire came and set upon every one of their heads. And they all began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. And they were emboldened, and they were empowered with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit, who anointed Elijah, the Holy Spirit, who anointed John the Baptist, and he went in the spirit and power of Elijah, is the same Holy Spirit who is raising men and women up now in these last days to reach our nation, to reach Ireland, to reach Britain, to reach those around you. And God is saying in these last days, he is raising men and women up to go forward in his name in the spirit and the power of Elijah. That's what God wants for every one of us. Seeking his face, willing to step out, willing to stand up. Listen, and you're going to be criticized. Join the club. You're going to be ostracized. Well, join the club. But nevertheless, when you're in God's company, you're in good company. When you're in Christ's company, you're in good company. John the Baptist, his goal was to turn the hearts of the children to the fathers and the fathers to the children, as it were, and then to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. What is our goal as the church? To make people prepared. To make a people ready, prepared for the coming of the Lord. To make a people ready and prepared. Our nation has backslidden so far, become so atrociously sinful. Our nation is no longer a Christian nation. I know we like to think it, but it isn't. It's an apostate nation. It's a godless nation. It's an atheist nation. It's a nation full of men and women who don't even know anything to do with the gospel. They don't even know anything to do with Christ. We're still blessed to a degree in Northern Ireland. But in England, and even in parts of Scotland, thinking of John Knox, this is the 500 years of the anniversary this year of the Reformation, when Martin Luther went to the Wittenberg Cathedral door with his 95 theses on the 31st of October, 1517, and he nailed him to the door saying, "The just shall live by faith." Look at the state of our nation today. And God has sent the spirit and power of Elijah into our nation. Listen, by the time we look at this, we see Elijah, when we look at his ministry, now we haven't time to go into studies on Elijah, obviously. But when we look at Elijah, Elijah prophesied and preached to an apostate head of the nation. He went into Ahab with the word of the Lord. And he preached, and what happened? Famine and drought came to the land of the northern kingdom of Israel. Famine and drought. He wasn't ashamed and he wasn't afraid to go in and to preach and to cry against bad government. People say, well, don't preach politics. Preaching against unrighteousness in government is not politics. It's preaching the word of God against unrighteousness in the land. It's when men and women are voting on same-sex marriage and it's an abomination in the sight of God. It's when men and women are having gay pride parades and now we're seeing it flaunted in our faces and are wanting to teach this thing to our children and our schools. You see, we must cry against it. Amen. We must cry, oh, but we're afraid and we'll hide and we'll cover ourselves and we don't want to rock the boat and we don't want to be called unpolitically correct. We don't want to be a bigot or, you know, you're even a racist if you mention anything to do with illegal immigration. Brothers and sisters, here is the thing we must stand for. We must stand for what it says in that book. We must say God says that this is an abomination. God says that he's coming soon and all who are not saved, who are not born again, who are not washed in the blood of the Lamb, who are not trusting in Christ's full atonement on the cross of Calvary, then they will stand in the great and dreadful day of the Lord, guilty as charged. But it's our job to stand up even when people don't want to know, even when people hate us for it, even when people call us all sorts of names, and we must say enough is enough. We must say enough is enough. No turning back. No turning back. And proclaiming Christ from every rooftop. Proclaiming Christ from every corner again. Proclaiming Christ wherever we are. Elijah went into Ahab and says, "As the Lord God of Israel liveth, before whom I stand." Now listen, brothers and sisters. the Lord God of Israel is still alive. Our Lord and our God is still on the throne. And we can go to governments and we can go to wherever and to whoever. And we can say, as the Lord God of our Israel liveth, before whom we stand, there shall not be. And we can claim the name of the Lord against it and cry against the altars, a cry against the idolatry. Brothers and sisters, do you know that when we hear of the like of Muslim terrorists and other terrorists, do you know that they're now starting to try to appease, to bring them into talks? It sounds familiar anyway, doesn't it? We should be well used to that. Sounds familiar. And what do we find? We find that they always want the upper hand. They always want to take more. They're never willing to even meet. Listen, brothers and sisters, and except there's repentance, you and I can't be saved. Except there's repentance from our sin, you and I can't be changed. Except there's repentance from our sin, you and I can't be forgiven. So why should the others? That's including the ones in Ulster. That's including those sitting in government. Well, well, they were. Notice this. Elijah took a stand against apostasy. The churches are apostatizing. And brothers and sisters, I'm here and I'm nothing. I'm just a sinner saved by the grace of God. That's all I am. And I have my concerns and I have my feelings like everybody else. And I have my problems like everybody else. But I don't know why, but he saved me. He forgave me. He washed me. He cleansed me. And for some reason, he's called me to do this. And so if he's called me to do it, I must do what he's called me to do. But listen, he's raising Elijah's up. Men and women, he's calling you to do the same. He's calling you to do the same. If you can hear it, if you can receive it, then receive it. We're afraid to pray in public. We're afraid to speak the word of Jesus in our workplace. We're afraid to mention him. And there's people, whether they're nurses or care workers. And I understand you're afraid. Listen, when you're afraid, you might lose your job. Hello? It's time the church stopped being afraid. We have not been given the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. And we have not been given a spirit of fear to bow the knee to every devil and demon, whether it's in government or in another church authority. We are not here to play church. We are the church. We're not here to say, well, you know, we'll just keep our heads down and be quiet. We are here to stand up for Jesus. We are here to proclaim his word. We're here to call the nation back to God. We're here for a reason and for a plan and a purpose of God, for the great and dreadful day of the Lord is returning. And all who are not saved, that's your loved ones and mine, will find themselves in judgment. Will find themselves in judgment. We hear of revivals happening everywhere, don't we? Whether it's Africa or India or China and all these, you know, South America. You hear them all over the place. But listen, revival starts in the church. Do you know where revival will start? When you and I get on our knees and cry out and say, Lord, use me. Here am I, Lord, use me. Revival will start when you and I as a body of people will say, we're taking our stand that our nation will turn back to God. We're taking our stand that we will proclaim Christ as Lord over all. When you start praying for the sick and not being afraid to pray for the sick. When you go in boldness of the Spirit. When you seek the baptism of the Holy Ghost, if you're not baptized in the Spirit, and when you start proclaiming and know who you are in Christ, and know who you are as the people of the book. Notice this. I'm closing. Thank you for your attention. God blessed our nation and the United States, Canada, of course, Australia it sprang from us, and so on. God has blessed us. But he's blessed right through the Bible with revival. We now turn to it, but 2 Chronicles chapter 29 and 30, we had Hezekiah's revival in Judah. That Judah's the southern kingdom. The house of Israel is a different kingdom. It's the northern kingdom, the 10 tribes in the north. Hezekiah, he revives the worship and he opens the doors of the church again. Do you know they're closing churches now to go and sit in coffee shops? They're closing churches to go and sit in some pubs. They're closing churches to go and do other things on the Lord's Day. Brothers and sisters, don't get me wrong. I mean, coffee shops are fine. That's all you want to do. That's fine. But the Lord's Day is the Lord's Day, and the Lord's house is the Lord's house. And it's you and I are to meet together to grow strength and to get under the sound of God's word, that we may go out the other 6 days of the week and reach those for him. Notice this. Hezekiah had revival in Judah. And under Manasseh's reign, it fell again into heathenism and idolatry before Josiah came, the boy king, 8 years of age, and revival came again when someone was willing to stand up and to seek the face of the Lord. Then Judah carried away into Babylon after they fell again and brought back from Babylon. And there is a revival under Ezra and Nehemiah, Zerubbabel's temple. And again then, through the apostles, where the Holy Ghost poured out. God sent the apostles west. He says, go to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. And when the gospel went west, we read of the churches being formed in Asia Minor, coming right over into Italy, and there's into Spain, and right up through into the British Isles. And the early apostles came to Ireland. The early apostles came to Britain and preached the gospel of saving grace before Rome were here. They preached the gospel of saving grace. And we see the declension, what happened. And then in 1517, the Reformation came, a great move of the Holy Spirit. And then, of course, we had the first great awakening in the 18th century under George Whitefield. And he preached on frequent and devout prayer, and it changed the people. And then Jonathan Edwards, 1741, preached that well-known sermon, Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God. And many turned to Christ, fearing the Lord. See, it's the spirit and power of Elijah turning them back to the God of their fathers. Notice this. Then the Second Awakening, 1789 to 1840, we had men like Charles Finney. We had Charles Hodge, Alexander and Thomas Campbell. Then we had D.L. Moody and many, many others around that time, reaching the lost and turning them back to God. Britain had George Whitefield, John Wesley, and Joseph Parker, Spurgeon, Muller, Booth. We had people like Hudson Taylor. And then, of course, Ireland and Dublin had Grattan Guinness. And Grattan Guinness wrote that wonderful book, Light for the Last Days, and the other one, the approaching End of the Age, where he told of Bible prophecy of 1917 being an epic year when the seven times punishment of Judah would be fulfilled. And General Allenby went in that year on the 9th of December and liberated Jerusalem from the Turkish Ottoman powers at the end of that seven times punishment of Judah. All these things. And he wrote that, by the way, in 1888. And he says, anyone sees this date coming? He's part of the Guinness family. The other half went in the brewery and the other half were Christians and evangelists. And he went and preached in the States, and he preached all over Ireland and all over England and parts of Northwest Europe. And he was a great evangelist, and he's a well-known character. So then we had, of course, 1859 revival. 100,000 souls swept into the kingdom for God. The 1904 Welsh revival with Evan Roberts. And from that came Dan and Jones Williams of the Apostolic Movement. They started it there. And, of course, they also believed, like George and Stephen Jeffries, that we were the house of Israel. Notice this. They also then, you read her, Horace, who was from the Pentecostal Prayer League. And then in the United States, earlier in 1901, we had Charles Parham in Topeka, Kansas. We had W.P. Nicholson in the Isles of Lewis, Duncan Campbell and the Hebrides under them. And these were all revivals starting to happen when the Holy Ghost was poured out. So, brothers and sisters, God is calling us. This is what God is saying to us. There's a great and a dreadful day coming. And listen, I'm closed. There's a great and dreadful day coming. A terrible day coming. And the nations are gathering and they're ready for it. And Christ is coming. And you and I need to start praying and seeking God's face, that the spirit and power of Elijah, which is the Holy Ghost who's in you, would start to move us. That we would be revived in our spirit to go back out there to tell the people, to tell the people he's coming, to tell the people to get ready, to preach the cross, the salvation. Listen, salvation is by grace through faith alone and in nothing else. And we must go and preach that gospel, that men and women will hear the word of God and come to saving faith. And we must prepare a people and make them ready for the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. Are you saved? I hope we're all saved. That's just by a word of prayer as we close.